I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. For he's made me glad, he's made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He's made me glad, he's made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad.
Hello, welcome to River Reflections, brought to you by Grand Rapids River of Life Ministries, where you are always welcome to visit or check us out if you're looking for a home church, or if you're just plain wanting to find more about what's Christianity, who is Jesus, why are some people I know devoted to the Lord Jesus Christ, what's this all about? You know, there's many reasons why you might walk in the door. And you're welcome for any of the above three that I just gave you. What you're not welcome to do is you have no intention of ever knowing the Lord, but you saw a cute girl walk in. Now that gets a little shaky, but other than that, but who knows? I think sometimes people coming in for a motive that has nothing to do with the situation, the Lord could use that too. Hopefully whatever the cute girl was, she's got the courage and boldness to let you know she can't fellowship with you if you're not walking with the Lord. She can't either, because the Bible says what fellowship hath light with darkness. If people are walking in the Lord and they're thinking about wanting to get married or even dating for a while, they need first to think about, are they also believers? So we're pretty strict on that. So you'll get your feelings hurt if you come in only for the cute girls. You wouldn't be the first guy, though, in the history of church that did that, and some got hooked on Jesus, and that's a glorious thing, isn't it? And I pray that all the young men and young women that are in our church are strong and care more about the souls of people that aren't walking with the Lord than they do about immediately wondering if they'd be a good dating prospect. I pray that all of the hearts of Christians in our territory, in our region, be tuned into caring enough about people that we don't want to see anybody go to hell. That's God's heart, that nobody perish because they don't want a relationship with him. Well, that was my little spiel about coming to church and what you come for, but I'm going to move on now to making resolutions concerning your walk in Christ. And this message actually is to Christians, but at the same time, maybe some unbelievers can get some things out of this, but basically it's going to be a Christian that this resonates with. It hasn't been that long ago, and I'm not sure when this message might show again, so I hate to date it, but in this particular night, it's not been that long since the turn of the year happened. And then we always, well, at least I do and many other people do, we think of the word New Year's resolutions. Most of us, I do. I always think about, is there something I want to change in this new year, and what better time to do it at the beginning of a brand new year, like a fresh start. And so when it was my turn to do prayer, there's three of us at church that rotate the prayer program. And it was my turn the last week of December, so I decided to address this subject. And then I made the whole prayer list into a sermon as well. So you're going to hear some of that right now. But as a Christian, there's some resolutions that are ongoing, biblical, and therefore universal among Christians of all ages, genders, socioeconomic standards. The only difference is going to be how we apply the principles that I'm about to talk about. In the Bible, it says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. What's the point here? I was just talking about New Year resolutions. But according to the scripture right here, as soon as we receive the Lord as our Savior, We need to make this line that says, that was me before Christ, this is me after Christ. That was me walking in the flesh, this is me walking in the new nature that Christ gave me when I was born again, which is his nature. So in a sense, when you're born again, that's the granddaddy of all moments to ring in the new and forget about the old, like we say at New Year's. But when you get salvation, that's the granddaddy of all when we talk about a new way of living, a new time of keeping fresh resolutions. The first resolution being, I don't belong to me anymore. I belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. And what does he want? Note that word Lord. He's the boss. What does the boss want? The thing about him being boss compared to maybe your earthly father, how he was, or literally your boss at work, or not all cops are sweet and kind and gentle and meek. Some can be pretty rough, but you still have to submit. And you can't always count on somebody that's going to be fair and sweet, even judges. You could have a different outcome, five different judges, five different outcomes. And not everybody's kind and fair. But the nice thing about having Jesus as our boss, he's love, he's slow to anger, he does justice. You can never accuse him of being unjust. He is the epitome, the definition, the touchstone that we go back to as a measurement of justice. He has glorious laws because he knows us. He knows what causes our life to be miserable and hateful and bitter and full of nastiness, and he knows what causes our life when we submit to him to be full of righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. So we trust when he says, there's the path, walk in that path, and don't look to the right or left. And in the Word, both of those things occur that I just said. Here's the path, walk in it. Don't keep looking to the right and to the left. Oh, I wonder what else is out there. No, look at me. Keep your eyes fixed on me, and I'll keep you in perfect peace. Well, at the turn of the year, we evaluate ourselves and see, how am I doing with this? How am I doing with making Jesus the Lord of my life? Am I adhering to that at all? Well, first resolution, and sometimes we have to do it every day, whether it's the new year or not. Some of us do it at our birthday. Some of us mess up real bad at night, and in the morning we start all over again. Thank God his mercy is new every morning. First thing is, we have to constantly crucify the old man. It's too bad that when we're a new creature in Christ, the old man doesn't just disappear and truly die, instead of us having to take up our cross daily and kill the desires of the flesh. And by the way, the flesh includes your mind, your will, your emotions, and the things you do with your body. All of that is flesh. The part of you that is connected to the divine nature and contains your God consciousness as well as your conscience, and where Christ dwells is in your spirit man. And when he comes to your spirit man has ears, he has a voice, and the Lord speaks to your spirit man, and then you turn around and tell your flesh man, this is how you're going to act. We're going to submit to the Lord. And in your spirit dwells the Holy Spirit, giving you the power to obey the Lord. But that doesn't mean it's easy. Every time we have a choice before us between good and evil, flesh versus the voice of the Lord in our spirit, we make another choice. He doesn't make us into robots that automatically keep his ways. You know, one part of me is sad about that because I make some poor choices sometimes, especially in the era of appetite that seems, and in the area of, for instance, with my husband, making sure my tone remains kind and meek and doesn't sound impatient. I mean, I have my areas that, you know, the Bible talks about the sins that so easily beset us. Well, so do you. Maybe you can't identify with an appetite issue, but there's something else that you have. Maybe you covet. I don't covet. That's foreign to me. I trust God enough that whatever stuff I have, it's sufficient for me, and whatever stuff somebody else has, that's great for them. I don't worry about that stuff. I'm not jealous. Now, I am jealous if you try to mess with my husband and he has the slightest look of interest and he's not getting what you're doing. But I think that's a legitimate jealous. But I'm not jealous if you get to do something and I don't, or somebody likes you better than me. I'm not jealous about that. In other words, there's things I'm strong in. I'm strong in forgiveness. God showed me so clearly what happens when we don't forgive, the kind of rage and bitterness that starts to well up if it's not put in check. So I have learned to forgive. That's one thing I have learned. But with my husband in particular, I haven't learned to keep my tones in check or impatience in check. But you know what you have that needs a resolution to say, I'm going to walk more in the nature of Christ in this area, and I'm going to crucify the flesh, and to literally figure out a way when you even start to feel impatient, okay, now you're not going to open your mouth and say something wrong way. Matter of fact, is it even important to say something? You know what I mean by saying crucify the flesh? That means letting the Spirit take control of your actions and walk in Him, not in your own knee-jerk responses. By the way, I heard somebody say the other day on a teaching on YouTube, and I thought this was good. He said, if you're trying to get rid of some things, some bad behavior through self-control, forget it. Nobody's tough enough to use strictly self-control to overcome things, to be a quote-unquote good person with good thoughts, good intentions, good actions. Impossible. That actually turns into self-righteousness. Look what I controlled and look what I did. I am a good person. Nobody's a good person. The Bible says in this flesh dwells no good thing. Now, they didn't say all this stuff I'm adding to what that guy said, but I'm saying these are all the things I thought of when the minister said this. And then he talked about submitting to the control of the Spirit of God. Now, His grace can give you the power to crucify the flesh and walk in the Spirit. And that's goal number one. Do it. Actually take on that new man. There's some things that might ring a bell with you. Your work ethic. How are you on your job? Do you actually work only if the boss is standing there, or somebody you're trying to impress is standing there? Or do you work? The Bible says, do everything you do as unto the Lord. Do you do that? At the end of the day, it doesn't matter what your supervisor sees and doesn't see, and what your six-month or year-end evaluation looks like. It matters what the Lord's evaluation looks like. That's all in the end that's going to matter you. So your work ethic, devotional laziness. There's another area that, I study a lot. But then there's some other areas like really deep prayer. And I pray, and my husband and I do devotions every day. But there's an area of deeper prayer that I sense sometime the Lord says get into. And then I might pray a little bit, but I don't think it matches. If I would give way completely and forget about all the things I think I got to get done, I get lazy about this and workaholic about this. And I'm saying some of our priorities have to be adjusted daily, actually. I was going to say from time to time. Hourly, maybe. it happens that we just waste time. Being weak in our prayer life, in other words. Giving to the flesh in spending. Here's a big one. How are your moods? How are my moods? Do I think a bad thought? Oh, she just gave me a dirty look, and I know why. She's thinking blah, blah, blah. And now I'm in kind of a tiff with that person. That person isn't even thinking about you. They had heartburn when they made that face. They weren't making a face at you. You ain't got nothing to do with it. I'm saying, look how often we let some bad thoughts give us an attitude, and then we get a mood, like a touchy, with a quick response, when we should just, you know what, even if they did, if you truly caught a body language or a look that was not right against you, even if that's true, then what's our response going to be? The Bible says, pray for your enemies. What about a friend who is momentarily annoyed with you? Bless them. Pray for them. Give them a pass. Never mind. Now, if they act annoyed all the time, maybe it's time for a talk, but you know what I mean. Our moods get carried away. They're like little helium balloons that cut loose from reason, fly in the sky, and by the time we give in to them, we're not being a light, for one thing. We're not giving to others. We're just protecting ourselves. That's it. I'm not going to have any more close friends. I always get hurt. Forget about it. You know, and or give them the silent treatment for a while. You're not doing me like this. You don't know who you're dealing with. You ought to be glad you got a friend as good as me. Nah, nah, nah. Now, all that kind of thinking, you die to it. There's a lot of things we have to die to. If we had a 10-page list with 50 items a page that were really picky, raking through every aspect of our life. Okay, you're a waitress. You just got some really big tips tonight, and you have to write that down for the IRS. Oh, they'll never know. Why do I always have to put those? That guy gave me $50. He just was really rich, and he gave me, I don't want to write that. You better write it down. The Lord sees it. The Lord knows the rules. God help us. I'm saying if you wrote some picky lists, but on the other hand, if we chose to obey the Spirit all the time, then just case by case, the minute we thought, I'm not going to record that, I'll tell you something that just happened to me. I was in Tarpon Springs last week, and I was parking in this parking lot where you're supposed to pay $5 at the gift store right there. That is their parking lot, right? And part of their deal making money is everybody goes there and they pay $5 to the clerk, and then they give you a blue sheet to put on your dashboard. Well, I'm getting out of my car, and I said to the guy that was just getting into his car, that is the gift shop we go bring the $5 to. He said, yeah, but why would you do that? I got a card I'm not using anymore. At first I thought, wow, I just saved $5, and I put it on my dashboard. I went and looked around, I'll bet you 45 minutes, and I got more and more convicted. What if everybody did that? And the whole day, people were coming and going, and about a third of their income they don't get because everybody's playing the same trick. Right? Now, I don't feel the same way about a parking meter that's got an hour left on it. You can't even put the money in it. It's got an hour left on it. So, I mean, you can't even pay that. As somebody else paid and didn't use it. But this particular case, you can. So after those 45 minutes, I just feel still convicted that it even took me around 45 minutes to go back into that shop, pay the $5, get the card, and put it in my car and destroy the guy's card. And I felt so much better. I did. If I wouldn't have done it, I still this minute thinking about it, it'd be like, now what's the name of that shop? I need to send them $5. I would just feel, I can't, my conscience, all these years of listening to the Spirit, when I mess up, that's the other thing about not walking right. When you mess up, the closer you are to the Lord, the less easy it is to shake that feeling of that one right. That was not right to do that. Okay, you get that. So you walk in the new man, you walk in the Spirit. If we do it 24/7, we wouldn't have those lapses where we do something wrong and then we feel guilty about it. And then, okay, I'm not going to get through my whole thing. I'm going to do this lesson for the next 2 weeks, but I'm not going to get through all the resolutions that are universal among Christians. But the next one is when God gives you a specific command, not the pay the guide command, one that has to do with ministry, life calling, direction, wants you to go to college, wants you to take music lessons, wants you to learn Spanish, wants you to go as a missionary somewhere. It's something that's dropped in your spirit. Now, I have some things that he told me years ago to do, but at the same time, I have weighed carefully his timing, and some things are still on the list to do that aren't done yet. Because I haven't sensed, I'd sense this is something I'm going to be doing, but I haven't sensed the path, green light, free time to do it yet. But it's in there to do in time. But anyway, I'm going to give you an illustration of a guy that did what he was told to do. Paul, who was called at one time, saw, And he thought at one time his life calling was, because he was an Orthodox Jew, now that's what they call that. I don't think they called him that last time. They just said Jew. But he was a strict Jew. I'll put it like that. He wasn't like a secular Jew or an observant Jew like we have today. He is strict. And he thought he was doing God a favor going around killing Christians. So one day, and this story is in Acts 26, verse 13, he's riding along on his way to do his thing, killing Christians. And then in the middle of the day, and he's telling King Agrippa, by the way, this story. He had to go to court because they accused him of now converting people, which you weren't supposed to do, evidently. And so he sees a light from heaven, like the sun, and everybody fell down. The people that were journeying with him, 14 verse out of Acts 26, and when we were all fallen to the earth, everybody fell out. You know, they were slain in the spirit. You could put it that way. The presence of the Lord was so powerful. Now, this is one of these calls that is underlined. It wasn't like this little feather in your spirit that we get sometime. This is one of those knock you down calls. I heard a voice speaking unto me saying in the Hebrew tongue, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And I said, Who art thou, Lord? And he said, I'm Jesus whom thou persecutest. Now Jesus is saying, I see you killing people walking in my name. They're called Christians. And in doing so, you are directly persecuting me. Then the Lord goes on to say to him, But rise, stand upon thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness both of these things which thou hast seen and those things in which I will appear unto thee. Boy, isn't that something? He's going around hating Christians, wanting to kill them. Now here come the Lord appearing to him saying, You not only are going to be a Christian and bear my name, you're going to go around and be my minister. And he says, delivering thee from the people and from the Gentiles unto whom I now send thee, to open their eyes, to turn them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive the forgiveness of sins and the inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. Now he's talking, remember, verse 19, Acts 26. He's talking to King Agrippa, giving his defense as to why he's preaching the word. And he said, this is the part really I want you to underline, put in red, and make a little plaque on your wall or something. I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision. And you might say, well, how could anybody be? Well, he had a dude named Jonah in the Old Testament. God made it very clear to him, go to Nineveh and preach. And Jonah's like, no way, Jose, I'm out of here. And he ended up in the belly of a well. And God touched that well after Jonah cried out to God for mercy. God touched that well to spit him up out, vomit him up on the shore. To be really academically correct, the correct translation is he prepared a big fish. But anyway, he got spit up, and then he went to Nineveh. So in other words, after that experience, you'd think Jonah would be really wanting those folk to get saved from destruction. Instead, when God did save him from destruction, Jonah got mad at God. I knew you'd do that. I knew I'd go around preaching to these people, and then they all fasted and prayed and repented. And he's like, knew you'd change your mind. In so many words, I know you're a merciful God, and here you got me up here talking to these people, who, by the way, were notorious for their cruelty, the Ninevites. And then when God did do that, Jonah went off and pouted. So you might say, well, of course I'd obey God if he was that blatant in giving me signs. Well, by the time you were in a well for 3 days and you got spit up, you'd think you'd try to get God's heart and vision for your life and do it joyfully and gratefully. Jonah didn't. You might not either. But Paul did. And he said, I was obedient. And that's the second resolution. No matter what you tell me to do, show me your timing, show me the path, show me the open door, help me not to miss anything, but I will be obedient. And then he goes on to say that he went first to Damascus and then Jerusalem, throughout all the coast of Judea. And then he actually went to the Gentiles, about which time the Jews kicked him out of the synagogue, they were so mad, that they should repent and turn to God and do works meet or appropriate for repentance, verse 21, for these causes the Jews caught me in the temple and went about to kill me. Now, if you ever really want to do if you get discouraged about the persecution, the rejection, the slander, I've been in the ministry now with River. Next year it'll be 40 years. We just celebrated 39 years. Before that, Robert and I ministered around 3 years in different churches, parachurch ministries. Before that, I taught Sunday school. So I've been around 44 years ministering to people. And I could write a book just on this is what you might have to face if you're a minister. People can accuse you of saying things you never said and then go around slander you and tell everybody else that's what you said and you're so horrible. I mean, it can get rowdy out there. Now, I say that and I feel like a wimp when I think of what Paul went through. He made a resolution, I will obey. And by the way, in another place that vision is talked about, it says that the Lord showed him the things he'd have to suffer. When he said yes to that call, he knew he'd have to suffer for his choice. So there's another resolution at New Year's and for the rest of our life. Lord, whatever I have to go through, it's never going to be as bad as what you went through for me. Never, ever, ever going to be that bad. And I look at what Paul went through. Look it up sometime. Look up the parts in the Word where it talks about being left to dead and stoned, and some guys, religious guys, took a vow that they would not eat until Paul was dead. He's been shipwrecked, left naked. I mean, he was just treated like a dog by the Jewish believers that rejected Jesus. But he kept loving enough. In fact, at one point, Paul said, if it were possible for me to be damned, and that would result in my brethren after the flesh, in other words, the Jews, being saved, I'd do it. Thank God. God wouldn't let anybody do that. Only his son was able to bear the punishment of sin for others, not Paul. But Paul loved the people that much, even though they were hell-bent on destroying him. Okay, what's the resolution there? I'm going to be obedient. One of my favorite songs is, though none go with me, still I will follow. The cross before me, the world behind me. I've decided to follow Jesus. When I first got all excited about the Lord, I was a social worker at social services, and that time we were at 2141 South Division. And in the basement, there was a bathroom that was real rustic. None of the clients went there. And I wrote, you know, it wasn't public and nobody had decorated it. It looked like something on the side of a barn. But anyway, I wrote that whole song out on that stall door in the bathroom so that everybody else could also be convicted to make the same resolution that once we make a decision to follow the Lord, whatever it takes to follow him, whatever death to self or cross in our own life and whatever our calling brings us to, we'll say, yes, sir. Walk with him every day of our life. And I pray in Jesus' name you find that same joy of submission, because once we lose our life for his sake, he gives us a new life of joy in him.